Islas 48, una barca costruita a Taiwan, progettata dall'inglese Bill Dixon.
Built in Taiwan, designed by Englishman Bill Dixon and sold mainly in America. The Islas 48 is part of a series of boats dedicated to the long, okay, very long sailing routes. This means that they are pretty traditional, with rather heavy dislocation and substantial onboard systems, with a very solid, centrally positioned cockpit, or one that makes sure that at least you've got a great living space on board. It weighs 20 tons, is 48 feet long, so that gives you an idea of the size. There are some oceanic sailors that like this type of weight. They don't want to be trooping across the world hitting storms in an ultralight vessel. But not everyone agrees. Obviously, there are families and sailing families, and each one has their own favorite sea. But one thing for sure, you can go anywhere in this boat.
La lunghezza fuori tutto è di 14 metri e 63, quella al galleggiamento di...
The overall length is 14 meters 63 on water. It's 12 meters 80 and 4 meters 42 wide. It has a Yanmar 75 horsepower engine, plus a 450-liter water tank, and immersion is 1 meter 98.
A prua vele per navigare in ogni condizione, la trinchetta.
There are sails for every condition at the bow, a self-tacking staysail for heavy weather, and the masthead is driven by an electric winder.
Una barca così classica può sembrare un po' un controsenso, la randa.
A boat this classic may seem absurd, with its furling mainsail, yet these cuts have brought about some great advances. In respect to a few years ago, and performance hasn't fallen much, yet safety levels have increased. You can maneuver safely from the cockpit.
Particolari della tradizione.
Following tradition, it has a dear old Dorade vent. They got their name from an Olin Stevens boat that was called Dorada. That's where his boxes that draw the air inside the boat appeared for the first time.
Gli interni sono quelli tipici di una barca a pozzetto.
The interiors are typical for a boat with a central cockpit. There's a big master cabin at the stern, and you get to it by going through the galley kitchen or through the bathroom.
Non sempre queste barche hanno la doppia porta del bagno.
These boats don't always have two bathroom doors to go in and out. This one does, and it's good. At the bow, there's a cabin with bunks. There's another double cabin and a bathroom.
La cucina a corridoio ha I suoi vantaggi. Il baricentro è basso.
The galley kitchen has its advantages. The low baricenter means you can stand up, which is handy for rough seas. It's a blue water boat that wants to go on long journeys. There is lots of space for provisions, two fridges here, or a freezer. Obviously modular, like all modern components, it's got vertical doors.
Ed ecco la cabina di poppa, il luogo preferito dall'armatore.
And here is the stern cabin, the owner's favorite place. This setup is often chosen with the central cockpit exactly for this big space. Another advantage is that its cabin moves a little less than the ones at the bow. You also have a view out the back, and it's not a bad thing if you are in the harbour either. Inside, it's a classic boat in terms of wood and finishings, good for sailors who are looking for the traditional, with things like this chart table. It's true that you can see quality in details. Look at the care taken over the connections in the electrics panel. Another characteristic of central cockpit boats is the possibility of having a complete machine room under the cockpit, which is great in terms of having all the systems together. It's easy to inspect and easy to open up the bottom of the cockpit to disconnect the engine. Something that everyone hopes they will never have to experiment with, yet sometimes it is necessary, unfortunately. The water tanks are below the cockpit too, so the Barry center is low and less instability, especially sideways when they are emptied. And another of the things needed for an Atlantic boat is here too, 1,500 liters of fuel. There are flutes for fuel distribution. This boat has a three-blade Brunton propeller, and at the moment we're going more than 9 knots, 9.1, 9.2, maximum speed. And we're sailing in the harbour here in Miami. Look how close we are to the city centre. Something prohibited in many Italian cities. It's gorgeous here.
Come navigano queste barche con un dislocamento importante? Hanno bisogno di un po' di super.
And how easy is it to sail such a heavy boat? Well, they need quite a big sail plan, and they usually accelerate a little more slowly than the lighter boats we're used to trying out. But as soon as they're en route, it's great. There's a certain laziness to the feel, slipping through the waves with no trouble. This boat really gives its best when it's sailing upwind with a medium to strong wind. Even if this boat, when at sea, needs a little bit of managing, it feels a bit like we are sailing in another era. In other words, it's a very steady course we're on. The boat responds to the helm, and you can use the automatic pilot for long distances. The cockpit may come across as small, and in effect it is a bit, but you need to remember that this isn't a boat designed to be crowded out with people. It's a boat that should be enjoyed by 2, 3, 4 people, maybe 6, and everyone should be comfy. This is the captain's chair. You might think it's funny, up on these high chairs, but I can see absolutely everything from up here. I'm comfortable. And if you're still in automatic pilot while you're sailing, you're onto a winner.